it's understood by other people that that place is actually in Andhra Pradesh or in some in more in Ahumpalam, yeah, over there, right. But at least they did come here to rest. And the deities, Lord Nrisimhadev has been here for a long time, and this deity has to be worshipped by a local person.
Another called Unkar Maharaj. From how long you have been in Navadvip Mandal Parikrama?
Well, we just began today.
No. And from how many years you have been there? You have been on Parikrama?
Well, I was on the first one. The first time we had the Parigram, 25 years ago, I was on it.
Okay. So every year?
I don't come every year, but in the recent years, I've been coming regularly. I came on the very first one. I came in the beginning. That time, all the GBC members came out. Kamal Krishna Goswami, Shivaram Swami, everyone was all out on the Parikrama, and we all stayed out.
That was the first Parikrama.
Yeah, the very first Parikrama.
Okay. So this is the 25th called Silver Jubilee Parikrama.
25th, yeah.
So you are witnessing both Parikramas.
Yeah.
Fortunately. Whereas we have many viewers online. I saw many devotees, you know, they are joining on this Parikrama every year.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know what they especially, you know, like find in this Parikrama. Do you have the same feeling to join, like to invite them to join on Navadvip Mandal Parikrama every year?
Well, it's not a very difficult Parikrama. It's, you know, it's only for 7 days, and the walks are short, and the walks are not a great challenge. The roads are not too bad. So often we have to go on boats also. And the talking places are quite good, much better I think than in Braja, yeah, where the places tend to be very small and confined, but here in Mayapur they have some bigger areas and more suitable places for speaking. It's convenient, many of the leaders like Jayapataka Swami and Gopal Krishna Maharaj are going round, they're visiting more than one place in a day, they're talking to one, for example, Jayapataka Maharaj will visit all the different Parikrams. And Gopal Krishna Maharaj was here with us, he gave a talk, then he went to the Hindi party and he wants to go to the Russian one if there's time. And so there's 6 Parikrams this year, 6 groups of Parikrams, and that means we only have six camps. So every camp is being used every night.
Yeah, in 7 days. Do you have any idea how many devotees are actually in this international Parikrama?
It seems like about 1,500.
Oh, sure. Last year we had, I think, 900 some.
Yeah, much more than last year.
So it's really enlivening. Thank you.
Speaker, and then we'll have a drama reenacting the pastime which Maharaj just told you about. After you see the drama, then it should be very clear, everything. Not very big in height, but very big in voice. Maharaj is from Krishna Balaram Mandir. His mother language, of course, is Hindi. Bhakti Nityananda Maharaj is from Mayapur, he's Bengali speaking. Yesterday we heard from Dear Damodar Maharaj from Africa, South America. So like this on Parikrama, you get an opportunity to hear from many different sannyasis from different parts of the world. They may not come to your temple, but on Parikrama you get to hear from them. So now we're going to have the drama. We want all of you to have a very clear image of the pastime here. It's very important. So we're going to have the drama first, and then after the drama, then we will do Prabhupada's Guru Puja. So please, everyone, stay focused, because it can go in the eye.
Don't become a wife.
When His Holiness Jayapataka Maharaj was in better health, some years in the past, when he would come with us, he would always have us to roll on the ground. But nowadays, you know, like here, this is more dusty, not very good, but there were some nice places that used to be grass, and he would roll, and after he would roll, then we would all roll.
Mm-hmm.
Maharaj said, you can roll here also. Yeah, because many of the places now, they put concrete. And you know, it's not the same. There's no dust anymore. It's just concrete everywhere. Concrete temples, so they build the temples. And it's all concrete, like in when we go to Champakahati, you see concrete everywhere. So like, it's not very pleasant for rolling. But here, it's dust. This dust is mixed with the atoms from the lotus feet of Lord Chaitanya and the Panchatattva. It's all there. So take advantage of that holy dust. Okay.
Yeah, just like one time the devotees were wondering how Prabhupada knew everything. They were thinking maybe Prabhupada, or the spiritual master, is the super soul. As we hear, we know from the philosophy that the spiritual master is considered the external manifestation of the super soul. So Krishna is the super soul, he knows everything. So they asked Prabhupada, how is it you know everything, Prabhupada? And Prabhupada says, well, it's not that I'm the super soul, but he said, if Krishna wants me to know something, then he will tell me. He said, just like sometimes Prabhupada would write to the temple in Los Angeles and say, you must make sure the pujari room is kept clean and tidy. And when the devotee in charge of the temple would go and look, then he would see that the pujari room was in a bad condition, it was not being properly maintained. So they were wondering, how did Prabhupada know this? And Prabhupada said, sometimes Krishna will tell me certain things that I need to know. So not that he has to know everything, but on certain occasions, certain times, Krishna will communicate with his pure devotees and tell them what they need to know. Okay, so here somebody is asking me about this pastime of Indra coming here with Surabhi Kau. He was asking, what did they do? What service did they do? Well, what was that again? He tried to please Lord. How did he try to please Lord Krishna? Because I was explaining how he had offended Lord Krishna by inundating Vrindavan and sending these Simantarka clouds to pour heavy rain on Vrindavan. So he'd committed a serious offense. So how was he, did he do anything to please Krishna? Well, first of all, he came and offered prayers. So that was the first thing he had to do. He had to come and offer prayers. But Krishna, of course, wasn't greatly impressed seeing him offer prayers. He just ignored him. But Indra has to understand his duty, that he has to continue his service. If we offend someone, they may not be very eager to hear us simply say, oh, I'm sorry, I offended you. But we can make up for our offense to them by serving them, by giving service. Try to do something constructive which helps them in their service to Krishna. That is a good way to help us to nullify any offense which we may have done or committed against another devotee. So similarly, Lord Indra, he has to go back to do his service and do it with a greater concern, acting for the pleasure of Krishna. And that would be properly pleasing to Krishna.
Jai Prabhupada, Jai Prabhupada. Shri Guru Charana Padma Kevala Bhakti Sarva. Rango.
Sir.
He said that where Krishna appeared, Hare Krishna. So Subhadra Singh was so overjoyed to have darshan of Lord Krishna. But being a great devotee here in Navadvip, somehow or other he knew about Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So after seeing Krishna and some Krishna Leela that the Lord mercifully gave him the darshan of, he said, I have one other desire. Would you please let me have your darshan as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? And sure enough, Krishna turned into Lord Chaitanya, golden form, upraised hands, and all his associates were there, and they had nice, wonderful kirtan. But this darshan of the Lord lasted for only a few moments, and then it was gone. And Sumudra Saint paid his prosperity obeisances and happily paid his taxes as a host. So we're hearing how Lord Krishna appeared here in the Dwapara Yuga 5,000 years ago. So in every yuga, in every age, Lord Krishna, the Lord appears here in this Navadvip town. In the Satya Yuga, we heard how Lord Nrsingadeva appears at Nrsingapali, washes his hands there. And we heard also, or we will hear, how Lord Rama also appears here in Navadvip town in Treta Yuga. Dwapara Yuga, Krishna appears, and in the Kali Yuga, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is here performing the same thing. Okay, so we're going to move on. Our main program is going to be at Champakahati. We still have to walk there, and there's a big program arranged today. Hare Krishna.
Devananda Pandit became forgiven for his offenses. And we were told also by Srila Jaipataka Swami Maharaj that in Kaladweep that we should all pray to be forgiven for our offenses, whether we committed them knowingly or unknowingly, that in Kaladweep Dham it is very easy to be forgiven for offenses. And the example is there of Devananda Pandit. Devananda Pandit was a pandit, means he was learned in the scriptures, but he did not have devotion. He was just simply cultivating knowledge of the shastras. But he had not awakened actual devotion for the Supreme Lord. So he had one kind of school where people would come to him, young men would come, and they would study Srimad Bhagavatam under this Devananda Pandit. So it is described in the Chaitanya Bhagavat that on one occasion, Srivas Thakur came to Navadvip and he was desiring to hear Srimad Bhagavatam. And this was before Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had manifested his pastimes. So Srivas Thakur desired strongly to hear the Srimad Bhagavatam, but there were no devotees. There was nobody speaking Srimad Bhagavatam. There was no opportunity for him to hear about the pastimes of the Lord from the Srimad Bhagavatam. So he knew that this Devananda Pandit was having classes regularly on Srimad Bhagavatam. So he decided he would go there and sit in on the class. So Srivas Pandit came there and he heard Devananda Pandit speaking the Srimad Bhagavatam. And just simply by hearing Devananda Pandit recite the Srimad Bhagavatam, Srivas Thakur's bhava, or his emotional love for Krishna, was awakened. And he began to feel ecstatic love. And he collapsed on the floor and he rolled on the ground in in the display of bhava, or love for the Lord. Now those students of Devananda Pandit, they considered Srimas Thakur to be a disturbance. They did not recognize that he was actually a pure devotee of the Lord, a Mahabhagavat devotee. And they considered that this man is simply disturbing us. And therefore they ill-treated Srivas Thakur, and they dragged him out of the house, of the classroom of Devananda Pandit. Roughly, they dragged him out and left him in the street. So this was an offense on the part of Devananda Pandit, because he was the teacher, so he was responsible for the behavior of his students. You can understand how serious it is to accept someone as a student. If the student misbehaves or does something which is against the principles of devotional service, then his teacher has to also take reactions, has to suffer some of the consequences of this action. So Devananda Pandit, although he did not do anything himself, he was considered responsible for this behavior of his students, because he did not stop them from what they were doing. And therefore, it happened that Devananda Pandit, later on, he approached Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and requested Lord Chaitanya to explain the Srimad Bhagavatam to him, to guide him in understanding Srimad Bhagavatam. But Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu refused him and said, "I will never give anything to you. You are an offender of pure devotees." In this way, Lord Chaitanya left Devananda Pandit, suffered the reactions of this offense against Srivas Pandit. But it happened that Vakreshwara Pandit came there in Navadvip. And Vakreshwara Pandit is another great devotee, Mahabhagavat devotee, and he was accustomed to doing kirtan. And when he would do kirtan, he would do it for many, many hours without stopping. He had great energy for kirtan. He was a very great, very powerful kirtan ear. Actually, there was one devotee in Prabhupada's time. He was an American body, black American devotee, and he was also leading very powerful kirtans. And Prabhupada gave him the name Vakreshwara Pandit Das. So, in the times of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Vakreshwara Pandit would do kirtan, and often he could do kirtan on his own. He would just begin chanting the holy name on his own in great ecstasy. He had so much energy, so much power, so much attachment for chanting the holy name, that he would chant and dance in ecstasy alone. So of course, when he was doing this, the people of Navadvip, you know, they gathered round, and they were looking at him and watching him. You know how it is here in India. Whatever you do, you know, you can gather a crowd of people around you. They'll come and look at you to see what's going on. What are you doing? So Vakreshwara Pandit was in ecstasy chanting the holy name, and all of these people were gathering around him, and they were not giving him enough space. He did not have enough room to really continue his chanting. But it happened that Devananda Pandit came there, and he saw the situation, and he very kindly kept the people back you know, he took some stake and he kept the people back. He said, give room, let this man chant and dance. Don't disturb him. So in this way, Vakreshwara Pandit was able to continue with his chanting and dancing for several more hours. So because Devananda Pandit did this service for Vakreshwara Pandit, Devananda Pandit later on got the mercy of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu instructed Devananda Pandit that you should go to Srivas Thakur and ask him for forgiveness for your offense. You do not know the glory of Srivas Thakur, that he is a great devotee and you have offended him. Your students mistreated him and you are responsible for that. You had not guided your students properly. So Vakreshwara Pandit went and also begged Srivas Thakur for forgiveness, which Srivas Thakur immediately did. He very humbly, he said to Devananda Pandit that, oh, excuse me, he said, you are my teacher, how could I offend you? You are teaching me. But actually Lord Chaitanya also instructed Devananda Pandit that you should never think that you have understood Srimad Bhagavatam. The Srimad Bhagavatam is the literary incarnation of Krishna. It's not different from Krishna. And don't ever think you have fully understood everything in Srimad Bhagavatam. So this is something of the pastime which took place here, that Navadvip, or rather Koladvip, that particular part of Navadvip, is a place where we can easily also be forgiven for any offenses which we may have committed in the course of our devotional service. We went to Dameshwar Mahaprabhu, and that is the deity of Vishnu Priya. The local people, at any rate, they tell us that that deity is the deity of Vishnu Priya. It is said that there was a neem tree which was in the courtyard of the home of Mother Sachi, and that neem tree was carved into the deity of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and it was worshipped by Vishnu Priya after Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took sannyas. Now it's very interesting to understand how Vishnu Priya was worshipping this deity of Mahaprabhu. Because in the Treta Yuga, we know that Lord Ramachandra was left alone. His wife Mother Sita returned to the earth. When Sita returned to the earth, Lord Ramachandra was left without a wife. And he had vowed that he would never take another wife. He would only have one wife and he would not accept another woman. This morning we heard that Lord Brahma, when he was just waiting for one wife, he immediately, okay, take another wife. So sometimes men are like that, you know, they easily take another wife. But Lord Rama was not that kind of man, not that kind of personality. Lord Ramachandra is Maryada Avatar. He's the incarnation of perfect behavior. He teaches all of us the perfect actions, the perfect behavior for a civilized, cultured person. So Lord Ramachandra did not have a wife, but as a king, because he was the king of Ayodhya, he would often have to perform sacrifices. And when a sacrifice is performed, the king should sit with his wife. When you have a sacrifice, you know, the husband and wife will sit together at the sacrificial arena. But Lord Ramachandra did not have a wife. Therefore, he had a deity made of Mother Sita. And whenever there would be the sacrifice, which there regularly was during the reign of Lord Rama, he would sit beside his deity of Mother Sita. So in the Treta Yuga, Lord Rama did not have a wife, rather his wife was there in the deity form. Then in the Kali Yuga, the situation was reversed. In the Kali Yuga, Vishnupriya does not have her husband. Her husband has taken sannyas, he is gone. But she has the deity of Dameshwar Mahaprabhu, that deity which is there. She was worshipping that as her husband. And it is said that Vishnupriya performed great austerities. She was actually a young girl when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took sannyas. Lord Chaitanya took sannyas at the age of 24. At that time, Vishnupriya was only 16 years of age, a young girl. But she was very chaste. Of all the qualities which are important for a wife, the most important is chastity. And Vishnupriya was the perfect example of a chaste wife, both as a wife and as a widow. It is said that after Lord Chaitanya took sannyas, no man ever saw the face of Vishnupriya. She kept her face covered. And every day she would chant the holy name. And according to how many rounds she would chant, she would eat that number of grains of rice. So you can imagine how much chanting she was doing. Just imagine yourself if every day you eat only that much rice as you chant rounds, right? We wouldn't need the big truck to bring all the rice here. So this is Vishnupriya's wonderful behavior. And she lived until a very old age. Of course, she was, I can't remember exactly what was her age, 80?
96,
right. Okay, thank you. So she remained in this world to the age of 96 here in Navadvip in Mayapur Dham. So that is the deity of Dameshwar Mahaprabhu, which we saw this afternoon. And the shoes were there. It is said that those are the shoes, the korams, wooden shoes, which were worn by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. We don't know exactly if that's true or not. It may just be, you know, local people that, you know, they sometimes make propaganda, it makes more money for them, you know. But anyway, this is what the local people say. So the first place we were in Koladweep, that was the Bhajan Kutir in the Samadhi of Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj. We say Vaishnava Sarvaboma Jagannathaya Te Namaha. So Jagannath Das Babaji was the leader, he was the head of all of the Babajis in Navadvip in his era. He was the foremost of all the Babaji, and he lived to a very old age and said he was maybe 130 years old. So we saw in the drama this morning, how the Delhi devotees were portraying it. Jagannath Das Babaji, you know, he didn't have a wheelchair. You know, we have wheelchairs for the invalid devotees, but Jagannath Das Babaji was carried either on the back or in a basket or something like this. And very old, and but he was a very, very great devotee, and Bhaktivinoda Thakur had faith in him, and that was why he brought Jagannath Das Babaji there to the birthplace of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, for him to confirm that this was actually the birthplace of Lord Chaitanya. Another important contribution of Jagannath Das Babaji was that he gave us the Panchatattva mantra in the form which it is today, and he popularized the chanting of the Panchatattva mantra. So, of course, Jagannath Das Babaji, he was like the Shiksha Guru of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Bhaktivinoda Thakur was initiated by, what was the name? Vipin Bihari. Yeah? By some other Vipin Bihari Goswami. And when Bhaktivinoda Thakur was, or Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasati was arranging for the disciplic succession, exactly which picture should be shown on the disciplic succession, then of course the choice was there that he could have put Bipin Bihari's picture there, but he knew that his father did not have so much faith in Bipin Bihari, but rather, although he had been initiated by him, he had much stronger faith in Jagannath Das Babaji. And it was Jagannath Das Babaji's picture which is shown there on the disciplic succession. And similarly also, Bhaktivinoda Thakur is not the Diksha Guru of Gaurkishore Das Babaji. But the point is that the disciplic succession is based on Shiksha and not Diksha. It is Shiksha which is more important. Diksha is something which everybody has to have. You have to take Diksha. But the most important part is getting Shiksha. So you may take Diksha from who you like, but we also need to get Shiksha. We need to receive instruction from our spiritual teachers. It's not enough just to get initiation. There has to also be instruction. And that is true for the first initiation, and it's also true for the second initiation. And it's also true for our progress in devotional service. If we want to continue to advance in Krishna consciousness, we need to get regular instruction. It's not enough to just say, oh, I'm initiated, oh, I'm a Brahman. But we want to know, how much are you getting instruction? How much are you hearing? I was pleased to hear Subhag Swami Maharaj last night also make these points. He was asking one young man, how long have you been initiated? How often do you associate with devotees? These things are very important. You want to progress in Krishna consciousness, you have to regularly get instruction and hear from the devotees. Okay, so while we're waiting for the deities to come, I'll just go quickly over some of the questions here. Somebody asked, how to cut off our anarthas easily or quickly? Well, by Krishna consciousness, just simply practice the process which you're taught. If you follow the process, then everything will come. If you're not following the process, if you're neglecting some of the things, then you're not going to get the proper effect. It's very important. You have to follow everything, all the instructions. Just like one devotee, Prabhupada was saying, I want you to become a GBC. And then the devotee replied to Srila Prabhupada. He said, GBC or XYZ, I will always be servant of Krishna. And Prabhupada said, yes, this is very nice. This is the proper mode. So it is important for all of us to follow everything, follow the principles that Srila Prabhupada taught us. And then another question, how to get attraction for reading Srila Prabhupada's books? How to get attraction for reading Srila Prabhupada's books? You have to do it. Just read them. Read them again. Force yourself to do it. And gradually you'll get an attraction for them. In the beginning we don't have taste, but if you keep doing it, just like chanting Hare Krishna, we have no taste in the beginning, but if you keep doing it, then gradually the taste will awaken. Right? The example is given, the person with jaundice, he takes sugar candy and it's bitter. So in the same way, reading Prabhupada's books, you may find it difficult, you don't have taste. But keep doing it anyway, and gradually the taste will come. Huh? Someone asked, what is the real definition of sentimentalism? Sentimentalism, we can define that as being... being in the bodily conception of life. Not having the proper understanding of the situation. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was accused of being a sentimentalist when he was chanting and dancing in Benares. The Mayavadi sannyasis, headed by Prakasananda Saraswati, said he is a sentimentalist, chanting and dancing. He's chanting and dancing, but he doesn't know why. What purpose? He doesn't have any real knowledge or philosophical understanding. That was what they were thinking. And people often think that about devotees in the Krishna consciousness movement, that we are just sentimental, that we don't know, we don't really understand the philosophy behind the chanting, why we do it, or we just think it's some musical performance. But it's not like that, it's much more, it's a very deep meaning. And that's why Srila Prabhupada wants all of us to hear the philosophy and to hear, to read his books, to understand what we're doing. If we don't understand what we're doing, we're just simply doing things blindly, that is being sentimental. Oh, somebody told me to do it, everybody else, all my friends are doing it, I will also do it. That is sentimental. Don't be like that. Try and understand everything properly. But then you'll get much more benefit. Someone says, my faith and enthusiasm is decreasing instead of rising at the Mayapur festival. Please guide me. Maybe you need to go back to Mayapur. This Mayapur Parikrama is... for people who have got strong faith. If you don't have such strong faith, then maybe you'd be better off to just be in the temple and attend the regular program in more natural, easier conditions, in the temple compound, in a proper temple with deities and so on. It might be easier like that if you're so weak in your Krishna consciousness. Rather, this parikrama is for people who have got stronger faith and more enthusiasm. Preaching in overseas countries, I don't encourage new devotees to come here in India. Rather, I encourage them, first of all, get fixed up in Krishna consciousness, and then you can properly appreciate the holy Dharma. If we are not very strong in Krishna consciousness, then we may just see so many negative things, so many things which trouble our mind. So it's important that, you know, you have proper association, somebody guiding you, somebody preaching to you, taking care of your Krishna consciousness. And if you're having difficulty out here on the parikrama, then it might be better just to go back to the temple. But if you're enthusiastic and strong, then certainly you can make more advancement out here. Brahma says, how to identify what particular devotional service is practical or not for me? Well, you have to consider your qualification, your abilities. What can you do for Krishna? Therefore, you have to be guided. You have to have some, you know, senior spiritual authority who knows you, who knows what are your talents, what is your nature, and they can properly guide you and engage you in Krishna's service. Right? That is practical. Okay, so now we're going to get ready for Aarti. We will stop here. Hare Krishna. And in the center of the lotus is Antardweep, where the yoga peeth is. And the other eight islands we've been visiting. We began at the yoga peeth, we'll finish also at the yoga peeth and Antardweep. On the last day, we will come to the place where you're actually meant to begin the parikrama, which is Simantadweep, which is the process of hearing. So from Simantadweep, the next island is Godrumadweep. We began our parikrama there in Godrumadweep. Godrumadweep was the process of kirtan, and we spoke about the glories of kirtan. Then we came to Madhyamdweep. In Madhyamdweep, the process was remembering, and we heard also the importance of remembering. We were told that we have to do proper hearing and chanting in order to remember. And then we went to Koladweep. And in Koladweep, the process of devotional service is Padasevanam. Koladweep, Kola meaning the boar that Lord Varaha appeared there in Satya Yuga. So that's how that part, that island is known as Koladweep. So Padasevanam, we should understand how to perform Padasevanam. Actually, this parikrama is Padasevanam. This is how we can serve the lotus feet of the Lord, by taking part in this parikrama. We can also serve the Lord's lotus feet by serving the representative of the lotus feet of the Lord. Just like Srila Prabhupada has taken shelter at the lotus feet of the Lord. So by serving Srila Prabhupada's mission, that is also serving the lotus feet of the Lord. By serving Tosi Tree, serving Srimati Tosi Maharani, that is also another form of Padasevanam. So this process of devotional service can be performed by the devotees. We can see taking part in the parikrama, we're bringing Tosi Maharani with us. Devotees are carrying her, and we're performing also Tosi Puja. We're going through the different islands, and in this way we're serving the Lord's lotus feet. So that was Koladweep. Then after Koladweep, the next island we went to was Ritudweep. Yesterday we were in Ritudweep. Ritudweep means we saw the beauty of Ritudweep. All the six seasons are present there simultaneously in that beautiful island. Just like last night, our camp's in Ritudweep, right? No? Oh, where?
Dhyanudweep.
Oh, it's Dhyanudweep. Oh, okay. Near to Ritudweep. Very near Ritudweep. So our camp was in Chanudweep. So Ritudweep, in Ritudweep, what is the process there?
Huh?
Artanam. Janani Vasprabhu is not here today to speak to us. Yeah. Yeah? So later on we will hear something about Artanam. Is he here? Okay, I never know which one's Janani Vas and which one's... Thank you very much, Janani Vas.
Those of you who want to know more, as Jananivas Prabhu said, try to understand more about deity worship. You have to take the deity worship course, the Mayapur Institute. Not only 4 months, they have shorter courses now, right? Yeah. Jananivas, you have some shorter courses, a few days?
Yeah,
they have short. They have very nice courses, very valuable. Devotees get a lot of benefit taking these courses. So we said Archanam was the process in Ritu Dweep, and then from Ritu Dweep we went to Janu Dweep, and then Janu Dweep the process is
Vandanam.
Okay, Vandanam, offering prayers. So offering prayers, that is the business of devotees. Are you all praying? What are you praying for? Many don't let me bump my toe on the big stones, right? Protect my feet. Devotees whose lips are always decorated with prayers to Lord Krishna are always given respect by great saintly persons, and such devotees are worshipable by the demigods. So Lord Chaitanya has given us the easy process by which we can pray, simply by chanting the holy names, chanting the Hare Krishna mantra. That is the great prayer for deliverance. Chanting the Maha mantra is a prayer, and it is also the answer to our prayers. By chanting the holy name, we are praying to the Lord. O Supreme Lord Krishna, O Supreme Energy of the Lord Hari, please engage me in your service. And by chanting at that time, our prayers are being answered, because we are being engaged in the service of Krishna. So the chanting is, of course, in the Kali Yuga, it's the only way. It's a prayer and it's the answer to our prayers. Srila Prabhupada had one discussion with one American blues singer. He was a blues singer from the southern part of USA. He was quite well known, famous man. His name was the Reverend Gary Davis. He was a minister. He had his own church and so on. Gospel singer, right? So he came to meet Prabhupada, and he was saying to Prabhupada, he was asking Prabhupada, Swamiji, what to pray for? Because as a minister, as a gospel preacher, he knew that many people were praying to God. Just like we see also here in India, many people pray. But what do they pray for? A nice house, a wife, a home, all by the sea, Jai Jagadish Hare, something like that. You know, prayers can be very material. We have so many mundane desires. You listen to the normal sermon delivered in any place of religion, and they have a big list. Like you go in a store and you would ask, give me this, half a kilo of this, 2 kilos of that. So we come and we have a big list. Give me good health, give me long life, give me prosperity, let my daughter get married, let my son pass his exams. So many things we ask for, mundane things. So this Gary Davis was asking Prabhupada, Swamiji, what to pray for? What to pray for? To him, it was not clear. Although he was a preacher, although he was working in the field of spreading the word of God, he was not clear about what we should actually pray for. So Srila Prabhupada enlightened him and explained to him that we should simply pray to the Lord, please engage me in your service. This is the constant prayer of the devotee. So Lord Chaitanya in the Shikshastikam also, he teaches us like that.
Najanam najanam na sundarim kavitam va jagadishakamaye mama janmani janmanishware bhavatat bhakti rahitaki. O mighty Lord, I have no desire to accumulate wealth or to enjoy followers or beautiful women. I simply want your causeless devotional service, birth after birth. So a devotee does not even desire liberation. The devotee's mood, our only desire is your causeless devotional service, birth after birth. So parikrama, we should have that mood. Let me continue to perform this parikrama continuously. Let me remember this parikrama, take the memories of it with me wherever I go, and that way I will always be remembering Krishna. And remembering that we should pray not just for our own, pray that we can be devotees, that we can engage in service ourselves, but pray that we can also give that mercy of Krishna to others. Distributing books, very important. Mayapur temple, Mayapur yatra are doing wonderful contribution to the world. Every year they're top in book distribution, last 2 years anyway. They've defeated Delhi, although Delhi has so many devotees. And in England, Kavichandra Swami was telling me, in England they have 500 devotees go out on book distribution for the Christmas marathon. 500 people were out there distributing books, including Shivaram Swami. So like this, but Mayapur are number one in the world. And there's not a lot of money here in Mayapur. We can see Mayapur is not a rich, not materially, it's not rich, you know. How do they make that? They go all over India. They go not only over Bengal, all over Bengal, they're going all over India, everywhere. So that is their real service to Krishna. So we pray that Mayapur continue to distribute books. We also pray Delhi will also continue to compete with them. Nobody can compete with Mayapur, that's right. Look, this is the birthplace of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. 100 brahmacharis distributing books throughout the year. Yeah. So that is very nice. Nice fortunate souls that they could come to Mayapur and be engaged in book distribution. Okay, so that's it. We're speaking about prayer here. In Janamuni's ashram, in Janudweep, Janamuni ashram, he was sitting there one day peacefully in his ashram when all of a sudden a great flood of water came through. Right? Because Bhagirath Maharaj was doing his austerities and he brought the Ganga down. So that Ganga came flowing right through his ashram. Swept away everything. His Akshman cup and all of his puja paraphernalia. Janani Vas Prabhu was speaking about the 16 items for paraphernalia. It all got swallowed in the Ganga. And Chanamoni thought, what is this? So he swallowed the Ganga. Just like we get really thirsty after parikrama, right? You're having a big kirtan, a lot of kirtan, Dira Damodar Maharaj leading the kirtan, and everybody's dancing and jumping and shouting and sweating, and afterwards then you want to drink the Ganga. So Janamuni did that, he drank the whole Ganga. So then Bhagirath Maharaj was wondering, where's the Ganga, what happened? What about the sons of Saga? We have to deliver them. So then they pleaded with Janamuni, and then from his knee, then Mother Ganga came out. Mother Ganga therefore got the name Janavi. So the Ganga came from the knee of Janamuni. So Ganga is like the daughter of Janamuni. And then Mother Ganges, she has a son, right? Mother Ganga, that the persona of Mother Ganga, she met with Maharaj Santanu. And from Maharaj Santanu, then Bhishma was born, right? So Bhishma's grandfather is Janumuni. So, you know, when you have a grandfather, you know, the grandson like to go to see the grandfather. Prabhupada taught us, grandfather is very merciful. Father will find the fault. He will chastise. He will say stupid, rascal, nonsense. But grandfather will say, don't worry, it's okay. Grandfather is very gentle, right? So Prabhupada taught us like that. He said our spiritual grandfather is very merciful to us, tolerates us. So Bhishma would come and visit also Janamuni's ashram there. So there was not a lot of, it's not a very big island, Janudweep, so we only had one pastime to visit there. And from that, from Janudweep, we came into Modadrumdweep. Modadrumdweep. And in Modadrumdweep, the process is Dashyam.
Someone give me money. If you give me a car, then I'll go for Sankirtan. If you give me a, you know, no, you, whatever you have, you use it. And not that you just give up everything. If you're very rich, it doesn't mean you just throw it away or something, and you use it for Krishna one way or another. You might have to take advice from others. If you have, you know, all kinds of education and some kind of technology or marketing or whatever, then use that for Krishna. But make sure you're using it for Krishna, not thinking I have to have these things, otherwise I can't be a devotee or I can't preach. Then there's another part.
It says, in relation to this, I just like to add a little bit that Srila Prabhupada did tell us some things like electric shavers are not necessary, and washing machines, you know, to put your clothes in some washing machine, this is not necessary. We can manage without these things. We just become dependent on technology when we start to use these kind of things. So, as much as possible, we try to avoid becoming dependent, you know, like an electronic toothbrush, you know, something to brush our teeth for us, and all of these kind of things, devices, that they're not necessary. We can live without these things, and we have been living without them for a long time. Air conditioners everywhere, also something, you know, I never really saw Srila Prabhupada use air conditioners.
Never used, he didn't like it.
Yeah.
Someone told him in the car, he rolled down the window, they said, Prabhupada, this car has air conditioning. And he said, I like the sky conditioning. So he never used the air conditioning. He used a cooler fan in Vrindavan, an evaporation cooler, but never that mechanical. So we have to be careful, you know, when we become dependent. And but we can use so many things that help us to preach also, like microphones and speakers, and just want to use them properly. That's the other side of this one is, on one side there is the principle of Yukta Vairagya. On the other side there are seemingly contradictory instructions of Srila Prabhupada in regard to Varnashram farm community. Please enlighten in this regard. And seemingly is an important word in this question. Like there's many times Prabhupada says seemingly contradictory things in the scripture. The one he gives the most is the cow of dung. The scripture says if you touch the stool of an animal, you have to have a bath. It's totally a very toxic thing. But then this cow dung is antiseptic. And you should use it for cleaning the altar and cleaning the deity paraphernalia. And you use it, you know, for your bath. And we have cow urine toothpaste and everything. So, but then he said how some scientists tested and found out that cow dung has all these antiseptic qualities. But other stool is completely septic. So that's seemingly contradictory. And there's many, many things like that. It's our own seemingly. So that Yukta Vairagya, for preaching, for living, we want the simplest living and the highest thinking. But for preaching, we need, you know, we use cars, we use telephones and internet and all those things. It's very useful, right? But not that we just want to get more and more technology and be proud of technology. For living, we don't need, and we don't need tractors and all that for farming. It's actually, you know, more and more science is proving, and in India especially, they come to realize how the so-called green revolution with all the technology has caused a terrible disaster in agriculture. And the people are going back to bullock power and cow dung and composting, and they're starting to flourish. And otherwise, farmers are suiciding, and everything is going all wrong, you know, because of trying to use all this high-tech stuff for so-called higher yield. So there's always, you know, not that we throw away everything, but we use things that are needed for spreading Krishna consciousness. But if we can live the most simple life, don't need so much things. We're supposed to love people and use things, but now they say we love things and we use people. We're exploiting the people, but we love our things. But it should be the other way around. It's all a matter of, you know, some discrimination, intelligence, guidance. Prabhupada used things when we hear from Gargamuni Prabhu, and Prabhupada was typing when he was translating. And he wasn't a fast typist. He was, you know, or he was writing by hand sometimes. And Gargamuni saw this dictaphone in the window of his shop, and he didn't even know what it was, but it looked interesting. So he asked the guy, what is it? And he told him, it's a recording thing. And he said, could someone who's translating, could they use that? And he said, yes. He said, so Gargamuni bought it, and the man said, I'll show you how to use it. And they had the book, and Gargamuni for 2 hours was in the shop to learn how to use this thing. And he took it to Prabhupada, and he said, Prabhupada, I got this thing for you. And they say you can really use this to help it speed up your translating. And Prabhupada picked it up, and Gargamuni was saying, I have the book, and I can teach you. And Prabhupada fooled around for a couple of minutes and started using it. And he used it all, you know, from then on, so he could translate so much faster. But then he had to engage other people that could type. The Bhaktivedanta Book Trust is one of the first desktop publishing, first publishers to really use computers more thoroughly. Prabhupada is very happy with all that, because we get more books published. But he didn't want this. Now we have, you know, they had this thing, teletype machine.
Okay.
Type on one end and it would type out on the other end at the same time. Prabhupada said, no, we don't want that. Devotees will just gossip. But now we have internet and WeChat and WhatsApp and Line and all these things, and we have to be careful. We are very valuable, but we have to be very careful.
Yeah. It's not that everyone is able to or meant to be involved in the farming communities. So long as the city life is going on, we need to be involved there also. Preaching has to go on. So while simple living, high thinking is encouraged, there will always be some people who are involved in living in cities and more urban situations.
And using all the technology.
Yeah. Certainly Prabhupada expected us to keep up with technology. Cars. Prabhupada expected us to have cars. Prabhupada expected us to, you know what was going on in the world, not to be behind. So these things are important, you know, using the internet, telecommunication, it's part of life, and Prabhupada expected us to use it in fighting for Krishna. Okay.
If anybody there has a question, you can write it out.
So here's another question. Devotee asks his question is, how to control or uproot the desire for respect or fame? So, Lord Chaitanya has taught us the process, how to conquer over this desire for fame and respect, through chanting the holy name, by constant chanting of the holy name, and rendering service to the devotees. It's described in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, when Lord Chaitanya cured the diseased body of the leper Vasudeva. His body was riddled with leprosy, but when worms would fall out from his body, he would pick them up and put them back into his body. So he came to meet Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu embraced him. And when Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu embraced him, immediately his body became cured. Miraculously, his body became healthy. But then the Brahmana, this Vasudeva, he was a Brahmana, but although he had leprosy, he said to Lord Chaitanya, he said, now I will become proud. What will I do? Because I've got the healthy body, I may have desires for sense gratification, I will become proud. So Lord Chaitanya told him, yes, therefore you must constantly chant the holy name and serve the devotees. So these two things can help us to give up this desire for respect and fame. We simply chant the holy name, constant chanting and rendering service to the devotees.
Mark. Yeah. Work to make Krishna famous.
There's no harm in being famous. Be famous as a devotee.
If you become famous as a devotee, that's very good. That's the best kind of fame.
Right.
And you shouldn't be desiring you want to be famous. If you're really preaching a lot, you might become famous. Can't help it. But you got to remember that it's really Krishna that people are attracted to, not you.
And it's also said simply by rendering devotional service, then one automatically develops all the good qualities. There's a verse like that in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Yashasti bhaktir bhagavati akinchana sarvair gunaistatra samase asura. Harava bhaktasya kuto mahatgana manoratena sati bhavatomai. That for one who is a devotee of the Lord, all of the demigods bestow their blessings on him, and all of the good qualities of the demigods develop on that person. So humility is certainly a very important quality. And if we have this desire for respect and fame, then this is not humility. Prabhupada writes in the Bhagavad Gita that humility means not to be anxious to be honored by others. we should offer all respect to others and not to be anxious for respect for ourselves. Therefore, constantly remembering this instruction, reminding ourselves, don't be eager to be honored or to be famous, but just try to be a devotee. Don't try to be the best devotee. Just try to be a devotee.
Kindly explain how the to understand acharyas have different opinions on dhams and pastimes or pastime places. I didn't know they did have different opinions. So it's hard to explain. Right? You ever heard of that? Which acharyas have different... I haven't. I couldn't explain it. So how do you explain that acharyas have different opinions on the dham and the pastimes?
We see that also in Srimad Bhagavatam. Sometimes Jiva Goswami will say one thing and Vishwanath Chakravarti will explain it a different way. So different acharyas have different opinions.
But you're not going to do.
It's not that one is wrong and one is right. But they're giving different ways by which we can understand the pastimes of the Lord.
They're not really contradictory opinions, they're just, you know, they're just picking out different aspects of different things. And sometimes it's a little detail, it doesn't matter, but it's very rare. Every once in a while it'll say in a purport that so-and-so says this and another one says that. But then it's always saying that there really there's no difference in what they say. And we see the difference. The seeming contradiction, seeming differences, is, you know, they're not really different because it's all spiritual. Got a big pile of them.
Some acharya explains one in one way, and somebody explains it, another acharya explains it in a different way. It's the nature of the absolute truth that it can be seen in different ways.
Here's a more philosophical one, right? So, you know, there's different kinds of questions. The other night I heard Subhag Swami, stupid question, get to the point. You know, no good question. What is the real question? Don't quit, you know, very bang, you know, wham, wham, wham. This one is actually Pariprasnena, inquisitive, submissive inquiry. That's the right kind of inquiry. What is the Nagar Sankirtan important as book distribution? Which is more pleasing to Prabhupada? Both. We need both. So we don't want to drop. We went through stages in ISKCON where we dropped one for the other, and then it didn't work. You know. And just go fanatic for book distribution, there's no more Nagar Sankirtan. Then gradually we become kind of bewildered, the public forgets about us, and they think we're just after money. And if we just do Nagar Sankirtan, but we don't distribute any books, we're also not doing the real thing. Ideally it should be chanting and books and prasadam all together. Problems. So, book distribution is another kirtan, is another sankirtan. Books are kirtan. Book distribution is also another sankirtan.
Yeah, devotees would often try to get Prabhupada to say, this is better than that, and that's better than this. And, you know, somebody's doing cow protection, and devotees wanted to hear, this is the most important service. And then devotees wanted to know which deities are the most beautiful. The New Vrindavan deity is more beautiful than the deities in Los Angeles, and like this and that. You know, Prabhupada was not very happy to hear all of this. But devotees, they always have this kind of competitive mood. they want to be best, and our deities are the best. No, but Krishna is absolute. Devotional service is absolute. What is important is that we're developing our attachment for Krishna, and we're losing our taste for material life. That's what's important.
See, a humble pot washer is better than a puffed up book distributor, or a puffed up kirtan leader, or a puffed up pujari who's just thinking of the girls, you know. Prabhupada said you're worshiping the deity but you're thinking of a woman. Different things like that. The mood, the attitude, the humility is what's the most preaching to pleasing to Prabhupada. Like when Prabhupada, when he came, went to England that last time, so all the devotees from Europe, they came, they all did huge marathons, and then they went to Prabhupada. The German book distributors at the time were doing so many books, and they came in, and Prabhupada said, so what do you know about the philosophy? And he didn't even want to hear about all their book distribution. And so the important thing is not the particular activity, it's the mood, but everything has to go on. But if I'm thinking, well, I'm a book distributor, so I'm better than everyone else, then I'm not very good. And you won't be a book distributor for very long. Krishna will leave it. That's it, I think.
I was explaining how by doing devotional service we develop all good qualities. So someone has written here that if by doing devotional service we develop good qualities, why does Prabhupada always tell us we have to be humble? Shouldn't it be automatic? We have to understand we're trying to do devotional service. We're still short. It's not such an easy thing to be a devotee or to be a Vaishnava. Prabhupada often reminded us, we are trying to become Vaishnavas. And by telling us to be humble, Srila Prabhupada is reminding us of the qualities of a Vaishnava. We're trying. It's not just because we put on tilak and just because we come on parikram once a year makes us into pure devotees. We still have a long way to go. But this is the path. And it's important for us to hear what kind of qualities we have to develop. We have to cultivate humility. We have to be reminded what kind of behavior we should exhibit.
Yeah, if you're right, devotional service means humility. Service means humility, not just work, you know. So the qualities will come about if we're really doing service, we're really just trying to please Krishna. Then these are, it's natural, all the good qualities are, for the soul, are natural. You're in charge here, you can answer this one. What is parikram? Is it about doing more austerity? Is it about walking in the Dham? Is it about trying to serve more or something else? What is it in essence?
Parikrama.
Yeah. Parikrama.
Parikrama is becoming more attached to the holy Dham by hearing about the Lord and his pastimes in the holy place. It is also said that by performing parikrama, we're engaging in pada sevanam, serving the lotus feet of the Lord. It is one of the 9 angas of bhakti yoga. So when we perform our parikrama in that mood for the pleasure of Krishna, that we come here, we take part in this activity, not just to be with our old friends, or not just to come with our wife and kids and have an outing, have a change, but we actually come in that mood of service to Krishna, that we want to actually perform this activity for the pleasure of the previous acharyas and particularly for the pleasure of Lord Krishna. That is real parikrama.
Those other things are there, I guess. This is maybe pertinent. Without the guidance of a spiritual master, one cannot advance in Krishna consciousness. But I find myself highly disqualified to approach a spiritual master. They say that spiritual master takes the punishment for the offenses committed by the disciple. Can they remove this cloud of doubt and misery? Well, you can take guidance from the spiritual master without actually approaching the spiritual master. First thing, we take guidance, we try to chant, we try to follow the regulated principles. If we're thinking, well, I want to be sinful, of course, then what is the use of approaching the spiritual master? Pariprasnena sevaya. You know that verse? Everybody knows that, right? Prabhupada quoted very often. Especially one time he was walking with that famous Dr. Patel in Bombay. And Dr. Patel was Prabhupada's age, and he was Bhagavad Gita scholar, but he's kind of a Mayavadi mix, you know. So he would argue whatever Prabhupada said, and he would give his idea of Bhagavad Gita. And Prabhupada was getting a little fed up. And Prabhupada said, Pariprasnena sevaya. You're not submissive. You have to be submissive. Your questions. He said, I am submissive. Prabhupada said, you're not submissive. I am submissive. No, you're not. You're always arguing. No, I don't. Yes, you are. And went on like really. And then finally he said, yeah, you're right. And later he met, when devotees met him after Prabhupada left, he said that was the best day of his life, but he actually changed after that, started, you know, listening to Prabhupada. So, these
okay.
Are the ones
that are Srila Prabhupada
ki jai. Shri Gornitai ki jai. So, you know, it's good to be humble, but it's not humble to think, I can't do it, because that means you don't have any faith in Krishna. Humble means Krishna is very great, and if I try to serve Krishna, if I try to serve the spiritual master, Krishna will help me. Not that you think, oh, I'm no good, so I can't do it, I'll just be sinful. That's not humble. That's foolish.